Today we want to talk about a prayer that's always appropriate. It doesn't matter if things are good or bad or somewhere in between. It really doesn't matter what's going on or in us, around us. None of that matters. This prayer can be prayed. Here it is. May the Lord grant mercy. That's it. May the Lord grant mercy. I want to look in 2 Timothy chapter 2 in a short passage where Paul speaks those words twice, two times, in a very tough situation for him. Two times he says, may the Lord grant mercy. I think we could all use mercy at times in our lives. And I think we could all ask God to pour mercy out in situations where we're in pain. I think about this scripture that we're going to look at. It's a contrast of loyalty and betrayal. It paints a very painful picture of heartbreaking betrayal. Now let's look at it. Verse 15, 2 Timothy 1. You are aware that all who are in Asia turned away from me. Among them are Phygellus and Hermogenes. May the Lord grant mercy to the household of Onesiphorus, for he often refreshed me and was not ashamed of my chains. But when he arrived in Rome, he searched for me earnestly and found me. May the Lord grant him to find mercy from the Lord on that day. And you know well all the service he rendered at Ephesus. Paul speaks of this betrayal, this time when everyone left him in Asia, except for this one person that we only hear about in this passage in Scripture. He doesn't show up any other time, Onesiphorus. Not to be confused with Onesimus in Philemon, although some have speculated, maybe it's the same person, but probably not. And what he says in verse 16 is, may the Lord grant mercy on the household of Onesiphorus, on the household. There are some commentators who speculate that perhaps he's dead, he's not living, and because of all he did for Paul, that Paul speaking this blessing, praying this blessing on those who survived him. Not necessarily so, because usually people are mentioned by name, but oddly enough, this says his household, and we see it again at the end of 1 Timothy in the last chapter. Again, it refers to his household and a list of others who are just the name, the blessings being spoken over that person's name. So the loyalty of Onesiphorus is contrasted with this turning away in verse 15. It says these two people, Phygellus and Hermogenes, turned away from Paul. Now Paul's in prison here. It's one of the lowest parts of his life, one of the lowest times in his ministry, in a season when he really needed people to rally around him, and these people turned away. I remember a sermon that my friend Timothy Lowe preached where he went through the pairs. There are five pairs of people mentioned in 2 Timothy. And the first one, it's Lois and Eunice. They're the mother and grandmother of Timothy. It's in verse 5. And they're described as people with sincere faith. The next one is the text we're looking at here, where these two people, Phygellus and Hermogenes, they turned away from Paul. We find another one in chapter 2 and verse 17, Hymenaeus and Philetus. And it says that they, quote, swerved from the truth. Swerving is when you're driving and there's something there, a pothole or something in the road, and you're not trying to go off course, you swerve. Sometimes you get back, sometimes you don't. These people swerved from truth. And then we see in chapter 3, verse 8, it goes all the way back and mentions people in the days of Moses, Jannes and Jambres. It says they opposed the truth. So we've got two people who swerve from truth. That's somewhat accidental. We've got these other two who bluntly and blatantly oppose the truth. And here's this trajectory. It starts with this people who have sincere faith. Then we see these people who betrayed the Apostle Paul at his weakest moment. They went away from him. They walked. Then we see people who swerve from truth, oppose truth. And it ends with another pair. And it's on purpose, obviously, mentioning these five pairs, because everyone else is mentioned just one name. These last two, it ends in verse 19 of chapter 4 with Prisca and Aquila, otherwise known as Priscilla and Aquila. And we know those as the people who were faithful to Paul from the beginning to the end and were pillars, really pillars in the church. When we focus in on this trajectory of going away, of rejecting Paul's leadership and the pain that that causes in the moment. I think about one of the most painful and poignant movie scenes ever in the movie Braveheart. And it's this scene where William Wallace has finally gotten these nobles to side with him to fight the English, these Scottish nobles. And the leader of the Scottish nobles is a guy named Robert the Bruce. And these are true stories, for the most part, that happened, really happened. But there's this battle scene where they finally agreed to come together and fight the English. And somehow Robert the Bruce doesn't show up, and the battle happens. And then you see, and I think we kind of know as the audience, but William Wallace, the Mel Gibson character, doesn't know yet, but he ends up in a combat with a guy who turns out to be Robert the Bruce, who's betrayed him. He thought he was coming to fight with him. He ends up fighting him. He only finds out in that moment when they're battling on the ground, and then William Wallace pulls that helmet off of Robert the Bruce, and when he sees him, he could have killed him. And the look on his face, it wasn't anger, it wasn't rage, it was confusion. I think that's often what happens when we're betrayed, when people should stand with us, but they turn against us. And if you know, betrayal is just a part of life. It's a part of ministry, it's a part of church, it's a part of life, unfortunately, because we live in a world with fallen, fallible humans who have this fallen nature. And the look on his face is this puzzled, confused, hurt. That's what betrayal does. And Paul's describing that situation here. At my lowest point, everybody left me except this one person. This guy stuck with me. And what he did, though, what this Onesiphorus did, when Philegius and Hermogenes turned away from him while in prison, this Onesiphorus, he says, he refreshed me. Not only turned away, he says he wasn't ashamed of my chains. And then it says, when he arrived in Rome, he searched for me earnestly and found me. We've got two people turning away. We've got another one searching and finding. Paul's prayer in the middle of this, two times he prays mercy. It's interesting, he prays mercy on the household of the one who helped him. He prayed mercy on the one who stood with him. And why did he need mercy? Onesiphorus extended mercy. You know, in those days, when you're a Roman prisoner, they didn't provide any food. You're just in prison. You were dependent 100% on your family and friends and others to come provide for you while you were in prison. Otherwise, you'd starve to death. And the people Paul was depending on betrayed him, but this one person came and risked his own safety and risked his own freedom, perhaps even risked his own life by sticking with Paul right there. So Paul prays mercy on him. Mercy on his household. Maybe he's still alive. Mercy on him. You know, I always like to think of scriptures, and when there's a sermon involved, I always like to try to find where Jesus is in this. Where would he be? He's certainly not the one who betrays. I think he's perhaps the one who's searching for us when others betray us. The one who's not ashamed of our chains, our bondages. He's not ashamed of us. The one who comes to refresh us. The one who, when everybody else turns against us, Jesus is right there pursuing us and seeking us until he finds us. As we pray together today and as we continue to worship, let's extend mercy to those who need it, mercy for those who turn against us, mercy for those who stand with us. Everybody could use the mercy of God. And I pray that the mercy of God is real in your life today, tomorrow, next week, next month, the rest of this year, and next year.